Hello. So we're talking about work stealing today. I'm Pablo Halpern. I am the parallel programs architect at Intel. So if you think you came in here to steal my job, that's not what this talk is about. It is about work stealing, but not about job stealing. So what is this talk about? It's a talk about scheduling, which is, you can sort of think of it as a kind of a low level or middle level look at what happens in a parallel program when you've got multiple tasks that can execute in parallel, and how do they get scheduled efficiently. So I want you to understand at the end of this, like why, the whole why of parallel programming, the whole why of choosing different scheduler strategies, how we quantify parallelism, and you know, the comparing greedy scheduling, non-greedy scheduling, work stealing scheduling, how does that fit in? And at the end, we'll talk about the difference between the different kinds of work stealing. Oh, and one more thing. I'm wearing this shirt. It's got a joke on it. There is a very small elite group of people in the world who understand this joke. You will be among them at the end of this talk. So, why do you care? Why do you care? If you write a parallel program, you don't actually need to know how the scheduler works. So why are you in this room caring about why the scheduler works? Well, there's a lot of things you actually could do without knowing certain details. You notice that you could program in C++ without understanding binary at a detailed level and being able to count in binary and do binary arithmetic. You can program in C++ without understanding caches and non-uniform memory accesses and things like that. But notice, you know, and you don't even need to know what a vtable pointer is. But how many people here don't know what a vtable pointer is? Not many, right? Because you are a better C++ programmer if you understand these things. And a lot of, you know, if you go try and get hired by you know, these intense companies that do intense interviews, you get questions that have nothing to do with C++, but have to do with how do you understand the machine. And it's the same thing with understanding what a scheduler does in parallel programming. The scheduler is doing your bidding for you, and if you don't understand how it works, you can't direct it as well as you would if you did understand how it works. So, what we're talking about parallelism is, in C++, several different ways of expressing it. I have here, is there a laser pointer here? Yes. Good. Okay. Unfortunately, it's not easy for me to use the laser pointer from this angle. Okay. Well, anyway, in the upper, is this even on? No, it's not even working. Okay. In the upper left corner of the screen, there is code that matches what the parallel technical specifications, and eventually, this will probably be part of C++ 17, specifies for how you do a loop-like parallel construct. So it says, this is just like the serial for each algorithm that's been in the STL from the beginning, except it's, instead of serial, it's parallel. That little token at the beginning says, hey, this is a parallel execution, which means each call to the lambda function here. Anybody here have trouble with lambda? How many people don't understand the lambda syntax, at least enough to follow? Okay, good, I don't have to go into that. So the lambda is being executed once for every element in that range from begin to end, but they can be done in parallel, which means some of these executions could be concurrent with each other. I put, just for reference, two other ways you can express this in C++, and there's actually a few others, depending on the parallelism system you've got. The one in the middle is Cilk Plus from Intel. It's a keyword-based system, so Cilk 4, it looks like a for loop, but it's the same idea. The one in the bottom right is TBB. That's been around for quite a long time. Looks almost identical to the proposed standard one. But it's not just for loops. We talk about parallelism as a general fork join issue. And here we have the again in the upper left corner, the proposed standard way of doing fork join parallelism. So what we have here is a little bit more intricate, a little bit harder to follow. I really do wish I had a laser pointer now. Oh well. What's that? Yeah, I'm looking. There's a feature here. Here it is. Laser pointer. Here we go. There we go. So is that showing up on the screen? Yes, it is. Okay, good. Oh, great. Thank you. Actually, this probably worked better from the angle I'm at anyway. But I'll keep this in reserve. All right. So we define a task block, and a task block is simply an area, you know, some place where tasks can be defined to run in parallel. And inside the task block, we run a child task. The task is, first I should say what this program does, if you don't recognize it. So this is the world's worst way of computing a Fibonacci number. So to get the nth Fibonacci number, you can compute it. The logical way to compute it is to just starting from one and counting forward in a nice linear way. There's even a constant time way of computing it, but instead we're going to use an exponential way of computing it, just because it's fun to show how you can parallelize something like that. So the nth Fibonacci number is the sum of the nth minus one Fibonacci number and the nth minus two Fibonacci number, and then you can recursively go and compute those Fibonacci numbers. And because the computing the Fibonacci number of n minus 1 is completely independent of computing the Fibonacci number for n minus 2, we can do those in parallel. And so that is what this code is doing. It is saying, let's fork off a task to compute Fibonacci of n minus 1, and then while it's off doing its work, we can compute Fib of n minus 2. Then, at the end of our task block, those two separate tasks join it together again to a single serial stream of logic, and we return the sum of the two subcomputations. So two subcomputations in parallel, and they are recursive, so each subcomputation itself goes parallel. And therefore, you can use quite a large machine and get all the cores busy if you're computing a sufficiently large Fibonacci number. Okay, again, I showed just for reference the Cilk Plus and TBB. In fact, TBB probably has three or four different ways of doing the same thing. But I don't want to explain the syntax for all of them, because we really just be using the proposed standard syntax from now on in the talk. By the way, feel free to interrupt with questions. If they start getting too long, we may shut them down. But I'd rather not go too fast or too far. All right, so this is... So these two slides were just to show, you know, what we're expressing, how we're expressing parallelism. Now, why do we want to express parallelism at all? It's all about performance. It's about using the hardware to its maximum. If you have a four-core smartphone, which is what I have, a four-core smartphone, and you want to do some computation that is maybe in a game or something like that, you want to use all four cores. All right, to get that performance. If you've got a 1,000-core supercomputer, you really want to be using those cores, right? Because that's what a supercomputer is for, is to get that answer as quickly as possible. You might be doing it to increase the throughput or decrease the latency, or both, typically both of those things. You could be doing it for power consumption. So why build a four-core smartphone when a single core on my desktop CPU is faster than those four cores combined? Because four smaller cores are more power efficient than one big core. And the faster you run the clock speed on a CPU, the hotter it gets and the more power it consumes, and it's roughly cubic. So we want to reduce power consumption, another reason to go parallel. But the important thing is that we go parallel in order to use the computer maximally. Concurrency, for some other reason other than exploiting parallel hardware, is not what we're talking about today. Okay, it's a different problem. You might use concurrency, for example, to have, you know, several web sessions going on and they all look live, but maybe all of them are using just 2% of the CPU combined. Okay, because it's not about using the parallel hardware. It's about a different part of program logic, okay? So we have different goals. So people who have hung out with me often know that I like to really harp on that point, the difference between parallelism and concurrency, but I'll try not to get too deep into it today. If you watch my talk from last year, an intro to parallelism, I go into it much more depth. So the goals of scheduling for parallel computation. We want to distribute the work efficiently to the CPUs, and we don't want to do all the bad things like context switching and blowing out our cache and things that slow things down. So long as our CPUs are completely busy, we tend to think we're doing a pretty good job of exploiting the parallelism. Unlike concurrency, we don't benefit from fair scheduling. In fact, fair scheduling, the idea that you have some large number of tasks, possibly many more tasks than you have CPUs, and you time slice among them, that's actually not good for parallelism because it tends to give you the context switches and it gives you cache problems. So we don't really benefit from fair scheduling. So I keep using the term parallel tasks, so let me talk a little bit about what parallel tasks are. Here's our favorite little Fibonacci program. And I split it up into four parts. There's a task, you can think of it as a task that has to run serially up until the fork point, up until we call the run. There's the task at the end after the parallel work is done. And then you've got the two tasks in between, which can be run in parallel with each other. Okay, so we express this as a directed acyclic graph on the right, showing that the only thing that's in parallel here is the red and the blue. The others are not in parallel with those. So although we have four tasks, we really have a parallelism of only about two, except it's recursive. So actually, we have much more parallelism than just two, because each level down is parallel again and can be split up amongst more CPUs. So if we have some number of CPUs and we're trying to schedule the work, you do this work and you do that work, how can we do it for Fib? This is one way we could do it. So here we have two workers, and I tried to pick colors that differ enough in contrast so that even if you're colorblind, you can tell the difference. I really hate using color as my only indication because I know a lot of people actually don't see it that well. But here, what the light ones, the yellow ones, are being executed by one worker or CPU. So I'll use the terms worker and CPU pretty interchangeably in this conversation. Typically, a worker is a thread that is bound to a CPU, and the CPU is the actual piece of hardware, right? So we have one worker doing these three subtasks, and the other worker doing the rest, okay? A perfectly valid parallel schedule. Notice that there is, of course, no task that is being shared by two different workers. It has the tasks that be subdivided. It's not completely balanced, so chances are that the yellow CPU, worker one, will become idle at some point and have no work to do. Here's another schedule. Again, perfectly valid schedule. This is the kind of thing that you would actually find Cilk Plus might generate, where the work is actually pretty balanced here, except for this one node at the top, which is completely serial anyway. You have the work evenly distributed among the CPUs. So a work-stealing scheduler might generate this schedule. Here's one more schedule just for comparison. Again, the work looks balanced, right? The worker one is doing about the same number of these little tasks. And because Fib is such a silly little program, you can think of every task as being about the same amount of work. But it may be balanced, but it's not a particularly good schedule because worker one is bouncing around between the different parts of the program. So it's always going into places where the cache is cold and doing context switching, and so it works. But this would be this kind of schedule you might get from a single queue work-stealing scheduler, which I'll describe in a minute. Before we actually get into the mechanics of scheduler, let's talk about parallelism in general and how you measure it. So here we have a directed acyclic graph of work tasks that have to be done. And for the purposes of this part of the talk, each circle is one unit of work. So again, every place you see a branch here, it's a fork point where the thing on the left and the thing on the right can execute in parallel. The work is the total of all of those circles, right? The total of all the work, if you took one CPU and executed the entire program with one CPU, and you added up the time, that would be the work. Okay, so that's our definition of work, or the definition of work for a particular program, or subpart of a program. Span is the longest path through our DAG. Okay, that's why it's also known as the critical path. It is the slowest path through the program. So if you took one worker and it executed that path, by the time it finished, no matter how many other CPUs we threw at it, that first worker would be the last one through at the finish line because it's taking the slowest path. Okay, and the slowest path is also the only path that it's impossible to avoid the slowest path is what I'm trying to say. You can't get there. You can't get from the top to the bottom without going through the yellow path. Okay, so it's up to the algorithm designer to try and make that path as short as possible. So that's the span, also called the critical path. And then we have some definitions here. The time, TP, the time that the program takes to run on P processors, and the speed up, which is intuitively the time, the ratio of the time it would take with one processor over the time it would take with P processors. That's how much speed up you're getting, right? Regardless of what scheduler you're using, if it takes the same amount of time on P processors as on one processor, your speed up is one, which is no speed up at all, right? But you certainly hope to do better than that. And then the definition of parallelism is the maximum possible speed up you could get if you had no limit on the number of processors you could throw at the problem. So let's look at our little DAG here. If you count up the circles, there are 18 of them, 18 units of work. The span of the yellow path is 9 units. So our parallelism is the ratio of the work to the span, and it's 2. Huh. So you notice that we've got all these branches in here, all these fork points and join points, but our parallelism when we measure it is only 2. So on 2 processors, we might expect to get a 2x speed up. And on 1,000 processors, 2x at most, right? So your algorithm really matters. Okay, choosing a parallel algorithm and measuring this stuff really matters. You eyeball this thing and say, oh, it's got a parallelism 3 or 4, right? No, it's 2. It's really low parallelism. To understand work stealing, you have to understand what a greedy scheduler is, because the greedy scheduler is kind of our ideal for a scheduler. Let's keep track of time here. So Guy Blalock, who's one of the foremost researchers in parallel programming and at Carnegie Mellon University, said, in a nutshell, a greedy scheduler is a scheduler in which no processor is idle if there's more work it can do. Now you can actually also think about, you know, a greedy scheduler in any non-compute environment. You know, I got a little click over there. If somebody's sitting around idle, then you're not using your resources effectively. Right? Just look at half the government offices out there, not greedily scheduled. There's some math around greedy scheduling that shows that, you know, if you have P processors, the best performance speed up you could expect is PX speed up, right? You would kind of expect that if you throw 100 processors at a problem, the best you could expect is 100 times faster, right? And a greedy scheduler will get you within a factor of 2 of that. In practice, it'll get you very close to the perfect speed up. The important thing is that the parallelism in the program has to be significantly larger than the actual number of CPUs available. It's had like 10x larger, like one order of magnitude larger. Not like a lot, but so you don't want to try and parallelize a program with like a parallelism of 4 and run it on a 4-core CPU and expect 4x speed up. You probably go get something somewhat less. But if you have a parallelism of 40 and you run it on a 4-core CPU, you'll probably get that 4x speed up if you have a greedy scheduler. But you're not going to have a greedy scheduler because computing a greedy schedule is NP-complete, exponential time computation. So instead, we use randomized work stealing, which gets us as close as we can as possible to a greedy scheduler and doesn't have that computational overhead of trying to pre-compute the schedule. And I keep putting off actually telling you what work stealing really is to tell you what it isn't. And in this case, what it isn't is static scheduling. So static scheduling is something that's been around for a long time. OpenMP uses it by default on their for loops. And what it does is says, okay, we've got to do computation over this range of data, say 1,000 elements or 10,000 or a million, and we have so many CPUs to divide it among, so we're just gonna divide it up evenly among the CPUs, statically. Okay, there are some subtleties that make it not quite as bad as that, but that's the premise, right? And this works really well if all of the iterations are more or less balanced. Very low scheduling overhead. But if the iterations are not balanced, you have a problem. And so our little DAG here, and I wish I could have put many more hours of work into this because it just barely demonstrates the thing, but it does demonstrate it, that here we have some loop, and let's say it has only 6 iterations and there are 3 cores, okay? And so the first 2 iterations are given to the first core, the middle 2 to a second core, and the last 2 iterations to a third core to execute. Now what happens? The first 2 iterations happen to be heavy. They have a lot of work to do, and the others not so much. So the first core is working away, chugging away on this, you know, bunch of work, where the second and the third CPUs run out of work to do. And what happens when they run out of work to do? Well, in the static scheduler, they wait, they idle. And what was big enemy of parallel computation is idle CPUs. We don't like to see this. Before I move off of this, I should say there is a time where static scheduling is the right thing. And we have not yet been able to, we've experimented with it, but we have not yet been able to get the kind of processor affinity with a work stealing scheduler that you can get with a static scheduler. So when your iterations are really balanced and you have something really to gain by the same iterations always running on the same CPU, the static scheduler still beats out the best work stealing schedulers that we have so far. Here's a greedy scheduler that is greedy but not very efficient. And that is, let's just schedule each task on a new thread. So in our little code here, this is C++ 11 threads. We're just creating a thread to do fib of n minus 1, and then we do fib of n minus 2 while that thread is off computing, and then we join. And what's wrong with this? Well, it certainly does the computation, and it does it in parallel, but creating a thread's expensive. The context switching, when you've got more threads than you've got CPUs, is expensive. The cache stuff is expensive, and so on. So not a good way of doing it, even though it's technically greedy. An important thing to note about any kind of scheduling is that if the overhead of the scheduler shows up in the critical path, it makes your span longer. And if your span is longer, your parallelism is smaller. And that is the problem here. As one of the problems here, creating this thread is right in line, right in the critical path. And so the amount of work goes way up, the span goes way up, but the actual amount of parallel work doesn't change. So your parallelism goes down. All right, let's finally talk about work stealing and what it is. So let's first, I'm going to start with an analogy, the postal delivery analogy. So let's say we have a postal worker who has to deliver mail to this small section of a city, this grid here, 4x4 city blocks. So the postal worker starts at the center of this grid and has a bag of mail. And then she says, well, I don't need to carry all this mail for the entire route, so I'm going to divide it in half and leave one half on the corner. I'll come back to it. Then she takes the other half and starts delivering mail. And when she gets to the first intersection, she's like, you know, this bag is still kind of heavy. I'm going to divide it in half again. Do the same work. Meanwhile, another postal worker comes along and has the directions, go help, you know, worker number one get the delivery done. Comes and finds this bag of mail on the corner and steals it. And it's my work now. And so he goes off and starts delivering mail while the first worker is still delivering her mail. So now they're working in parallel. And the second worker, just like the first one, subdivides that bag when he gets to that first intersection. So now we've got two unclaimed bags of mail sitting around, which means we could get two more workers to help solve the problem, right? Get the work done. So that is work stealing in a sort of physical analogy form. In our analogy, each postal worker represents a processor, like a CPU core. The sacks of mail represent work that needs to be done. Each intersection is an opportunity for subdividing the work into smaller pieces that can be done independently. And critically, when any worker runs out of work to do, they go off and find some more and steal some more. So what do we see in this analogy and in the real thing? There's a number of characteristics. First of all, notice that we're subdividing kind of dynamically. Tasks are just sort of being created as we go along. They're performed by a pool of workers, usually a fixed-sized pool of workers. So in a computer, that's the number of CPU cores you have. So in the computational environment, each computational element, might be a CPU core or a GPU core, is associated with a worker. And at the software level, we usually associate a thread with a worker. So it may be hard bound to a specific hardware core or not. But generally, you have no more worker threads than you have cores. And occasionally, you deliberately use fewer to like leave some cores for like running the operating system and whatever. Any worker can steal work that was created by another worker. And we've got this kind of dynamic load balancing, and that's what gives us this greedy-like scheduling. That, you know, the work just kind of moves from overburdened workers to idle workers. But what's critical here is only tasks that have not already gotten started can be stolen. So the second postal worker doesn't come up to the first one at gunpoint and say, give me half your mail. What was that, a time check? Oh, thank you. Instead, it's up to the first worker to subdivide the work and leave something for the other worker to steal. So it's really not quite as violent as the name implies. But we do use the violent terms. We talk about the thief and we talk about the victim. It's just like, you know, when we talk about killing processes and so on. So only the tasks that have been divided into so the one who owns the task is the boss in terms of subdividing the work. So the postal analogy was lots of fun to draw and, you know, stuff, but really we're talking about C++ here. So what does work stealing look like here? So let's say we've got this program it just does a two-way parallel split where it, inside of this task block, it runs a subtask G, which doesn't go parallel any further, or at least we're not showing it here. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't, maybe it's recursive. And then at the end of the task block, the work has to come back together. So we start with one worker. Again, until it's been work's been subdivided, only one worker can be active on it. So worker one comes and runs all of the serial code up until the fork point. At the fork point, there's a choice. It could either run G, or it could continue running the continuation after running G. Here, I'll have it run G. And I'll talk a little bit about that choice in a moment. So again, it's still running serially, but now this little marker here is an important thing. Something has happened in the runtime system where work has become available for another worker to come in and steal it. So our second worker, worker B, finds this work available to steal, which is the part of the original function F after the call to run. Now the two workers continue in parallel, executing their parts. And then at the join point over here, one or the other of those workers will finish the job. So that's what work stealing looks like in a computer program. And in fact, this is a lot like how Cilk Plus does work stealing. We'll need to understand a little bit about different strategies to see why was it that the worker A went off and did G instead of the other way around. And in fact, both are completely valid ways to do it. And that we'll be talking about that right now. First of all, how does a worker find work to do? In our postal analogy, I would lead you to believe that these postal workers are wandering the streets looking for bags of mail to deliver, but obviously that would be pretty inefficient, right? It'd be much more efficient if when a postal worker left the bags of mail, they got on their walkie-talkie and said, there's a bag of mail on the corner of blah, 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 right? So there's gotta be a way that the processors communicate to each other, letting them know that there's work to be done. And the two ways, you can have a centralized work queue, or you could have distributed work queues. And in the case of distributed work queues, there are two big subcategories. There is child stealing, and there's continuation stealing, also called parent stealing. Let's first talk about the centralized work queue, because it's the easiest to understand, and then we'll get into the distributed one. So here we have our little piece of our fib program at the bottom here. And the algorithm, if you will, or the formula for the centralized work queue is that when a new task is added, it's added to the tail of this FIFO queue. And then when a worker is idle, it goes to the queue and takes the next task off. Pretty simple. Now, if you get to a join point and all of the tasks that need to be joined are not done yet, then you have to go off and help get those things done. And so take stuff off the queue until those are done. And so what you're doing is you're suspending the current task until everything that you need has been done, and then you can continue in the current task. So I have a little animation for that. We started out with fib of 4 starting in the first worker 0, or in this case I use the abbreviation P for processor 0, is running fib 4, and it gets to that fork point where it is creating a task for fib of 3, that is n minus 1 is 3 here, and it pushes it onto the work queue. Bundles it up, pushes it onto the work queue, and then it goes on to execute fib of 2, which is the part down here in our code. And fib of 2, it's recursive, so fib of 2 then goes off and says, oh, I need to push fib of 1 onto the work queue. There's another fork point there, and then processor 1 discovers, hey, there's work on the queue, and it steals it, takes it off the work queue. Okay, so the work has now migrated, a little bit of work has migrated from processor 0 to processor 1. Processor 1 also adds more work to the work queue at the next fork point. Oops, and that's it for this particular animation. Okay, but you can see it just keeps going this way until the work queue is empty and the stacks are empty. Everybody has returned up to their to the point. Okay, so it just unwinds itself at the end. An important thing to note is that if fib of zero were to return here, this processor zero would be stuck. It needs the results of both fib of zero and fib of one in order to compute fib of two. So it could just stall and busy loop until that was done. But if there's no other idle workers, that'll never happen. So it has to go off, it has to suspend fib of two and take the next thing off of the queue, which may or may not be fib of one, but it has to do it. It has to crank its way through the queue until the queue is empty, or until the join has been satisfied. So that's one of the weird things that you end up here, is you end up with this kind of stack of suspended tasks, tasks that are suspended waiting for other tasks to finish without knowing whether anybody's actually working on those other tasks and like that. So the characteristics of the centralized work queue is that it has these drawbacks, okay? So first of all, what should be obvious to anybody who's done a lot of concurrent programming is that you don't want a central data structure that all of the CPUs are banging on, and that's what you have with your central work queue. You've got contention. It's a queue. It probably has a lock, or else even a lock-free algorithm for enqueuing stuff is not cheap, because the lock-free atomic operations have memory barriers and so on that are costly. And with everybody sharing the same data structure, the cache is constantly shuttling between CPUs, these cache lines, and that's not good either. It's unbounded space requirements. I mentioned how you have suspended tasks, but you also have this queue that is growing kind of without bound as well. So depending on your algorithm, you could just really blow out memory with it. Okay, nevertheless, this is actually used and in fact practical for certain cases, all right? If it's very coarse-grained, like these big tasks and a lot of big tasks, so you have a lot of them so you don't have to worry about idle CPUs because there's enough of them, and they're big enough that you don't have to push things onto the queue very often, you don't have to pop things off the queue very often, it can work. And for things like processing stream of events, like network events or file system events maybe, and then like spawning off a task for each of them, that's sort of like what Apple's Grand Central Dispatch does, and it works for that level of parallelism. It does get the job done. Okay, but more efficient for this smaller grain parallelism are distributed work queues. So here, I've changed my diagram here, where each processor now has, in addition to a program stack, it has its own queue. And in fact, it's a double-ended queue, which we pronounce deck. So each one has its own deck. And the rules are, at the fork point, you add a task to the deck, to the tail of the deck. When you're idle, you choose another worker at random and steal the task off the head of its deck. And then if you get to a join point and the tasks at the join point are not done yet, you go off and steal some more. I'm sorry. At a join point, if there's work on your own deck, you take the work off of your own deck, but off the other end, off the end you just pushed it onto. And I'll mention why that's beneficial in a moment. So kind of you steal from yourself in that way. But if your own deck is empty, then you go off and steal work from another worker. Or if you're at a join point, you might stall until the join point is satisfied. So here again, we have fib 4. It is spawning off of fib 3 and pushes it onto its own deck. And then it runs fib 2 and once again pushes work onto its own deck for the recursive fib 1. Meanwhile, processor 1 steals work off of the head of Processor Zero's deck. So there is real contention there. So you want to minimize how often steals actually occur across workers. As we'll see, it kind of naturally sets itself up that way for most algorithms so that you have minimum cross things. So then now processor one is doing work and processor zero is also doing work. Processor one pushes work onto its own deck. And then the stack unwinds one level. And you look on processor zero, it just finished computing fib of zero. But it's not done yet, because it only has the results from fib of zero. It needs the result of fib of one. And fib of one is its own deck. Interesting how that is. Coincidentally, and it's not coincidence at all, that because fib of one is the most recent thing that got pushed onto the deck, it is the least likely thing to have been stolen by another worker. And so it just takes it back. It reverses the fork effectively. So we call this stealing from yourself or doing an undo detach. There's actually a function in the Cilk runtime called undo detach, where it steals work from itself, but it steals it from the opposite end of the deck than the other workers are stealing from. And so it is very likely that the thing you're stealing from yourself is the thing that is going to help you complete that join, because you pushed it on there, you're the one that needs it back. Okay, and so now processor zero is working on this. Processor one does the same thing. It reverses its last fork. It steals from itself. Okay, and then now there's no asynchronous work on the decks right now. They're all just returning up their call chain. And at the very end, whichever one finishes last gets the result from the computation at the joint. Did I lose? Hello? Yeah, okay. For a moment there, mic wasn't working. So there's finally the join there. Now, notice that in all of this entire animation, the entire computation of fib 4, a task moved from one worker to the other only once. Okay, and that is hugely different from our shared work queue, where they were constantly knocking on the same data structure. So in distributed randomized work stealing, most of the time, a worker is stealing from itself. Because once the work has been distributed, so there's a kind of a startup cost, right? If you've got 100 workers, and you've got some big recursive computation or a loop, even loops are done recursively, like the loop work is divided in half, and divided in half again, and divided in half again. We have poltergeists. The loops are also done as this kind of fork join, the divide and conquer way of doing things. So there's a startup cost, as originally you have only one big chunk of work, and just like the mail thing, we have to divide it in half, and divide it in half again, divide it in half again. And until that process is done, you can't completely use every CPU, right? Not until, but once you've gotten down to the point where every CPU has some amount of work to do, you can keep recursing down this thing, and you're just stealing from yourself. Unless things get unbalanced, which they do, in which case you've got this automatic load balancing and it steals from other workers. So, like I said, popping from the tail gives you a bunch of advantages, one of which is it's most likely to complete that join, which means you can finish your work up and pop the stack. Have fewer things kind of in process, which means better memory utilization and so on. You're also most likely to be stealing something that is already warm in your cache, right? You just forked this work. The data it's working on was just in your cache an instant ago. It's probably still in your cache when you repatriate that task. The joins can be either stalling or non-stalling, and there are advantages to each, and the different styles of work stealing that I'll mention have different preferences as to whether they should be stalling or non-stalling. And you typically design the program or design the work stealing system, the parallelism system, to make fork points extremely cheap as possible, and push the expense into the steal. Now, why is that? A couple of reasons. One is you want to be able to express a lot more parallelism than you have CPUs. I want to be able to write something for 4 cores today and have it run on 100 cores tomorrow, which means I can't have a parallelism of 4. I can't even have a parallelism of 40. I need a parallelism of about 1,000 in order to make really efficient use of 1,000 cores, of 100 cores. So you want to express a lot more parallelism than you actually have hardware to execute in parallel. And so therefore, you'll be doing these fork points all over the place, right? So you want them to be really cheap. On the other hand, the steals are proportional to the actual hardware. So your steals are much, much rarer than your fork points. That's one reason why you want to push the work into the steal. The other is that when a processor is stealing, it is doing so for one reason only, and that is because it's idle. And it's much better to give work to an idle CPU than to a non-idle CPU, right? And the fork is being done by one of the CPUs that's actually getting work done. So you want to give it as little extra work as possible. So we make the forks cheap and the steals comparatively expensive. All right, so I mentioned there's two main subclasses of work stealing schedulers, or distributed work stealing schedulers, child stealing and continuation stealing. First, we need to make sure we have a common understanding of the anatomy, the terminology of our programs. I've been talking about fork points and join points already. Just mentioned that a join can be explicitly in the code, as in the case of this call to wait here, or it can just be implicit at the end of a task block. And a child task, I've already used this term, but it's, I guess, about high time I actually define it. That is the task that is identified by some kind of fork call, all right, the call to run in this case. The continuation of the fork is this blue code here. It is the code that follows immediately after the fork point. It is itself a task, and it's really important that even though that looks like, well, that is just part of the task that was running before, not really. Once you have a fork, you have like a fork in a road, right? There's always two possible things, and they're pretty much equivalent as far as the parallelism math works out. They're both tasks, and they are in parallel with each other. After the join itself also has a continuation. We don't talk about it that often, but it makes a difference when we talk about stalling and non-stalling joins. In child stealing, the child is what is pushed onto the deck. How do you push a function call onto the deck? Well, you package it all up. You got pointers and context and arguments and so on. You package it all up into some sort of data structure, and you push a pointer and you allocate that on the heap, and you push a pointer to that onto the deck. Then you go ahead and execute the code that follows, the continuation of the fork. If the child task is not stolen, then you'll do this undo of the fork. You'll go back to your deck and pull the next piece of work out, right? And when does that happen? That happens at a join point, because so long as you're not at a join point, it means you're still working on something. When you get to the join point, that's the end of a task. And that's why it's so important to think of that continuation as a task. Because when you're running a continuation and get to the join, you have to remember, oh, I just finished a task. When it finishes a task, it needs another task to run. And it cannot continue from the join point unless all of the other children that were forked off have completed. So it goes off and helps to complete those children. So it'll notice that it'll work even if you have only one CPU, right? This is a very important quality of parallel programming that is different from thread programming in general. And that is that you want to use whatever hardware you have, however many CPUs you have, even if it's one. And if you have one CPU, it'll end up executing all of the tasks. And therefore, no two tasks that are in parallel had better depend on each other, because then you'll deadlock yourself on one CPU. You could deadlock yourself on 100 CPUs if you've got 1,000 tasks. So the the scheduler typically stalls at a join point in a child stealing scheduler. And that is because it's actually difficult not to. It's difficult to write the code so it doesn't. Now, in a parent stealing scheduler, it's also difficult, but that difficulty has already been amortized by the other difficulties in the scheduler, which I'll get to in a moment. All right, in continuation stealing, or sometimes we call it parent stealing, what gets pushed onto the deck is not the child task, but rather the continuation of the current line of code. And how is that done? Well, it's actually like a set jump. In fact, it's actually implemented using a set jump. It stores the registers and other whatever context you need to resume at a certain point in the code. It stores them onto a place in the stack, and then it pushes the stack pointer, sorry, not the stack pointer, but the frame pointer, onto the deck. And then it goes off and runs child, just like a function call. The worker executes the child immediately, like a normal call, I just said that. Then an idle worker comes in there, it pulls the frame pointer off the deck, and it resumes from that point. Again, you know, the rest is, you can sort of read for yourself, but if you return from the child, which like I said, like, it looks like a normal function call, and the parent has not been stolen, you just keep executing. You have to pull it off the deck. You have to undo the thing. But except for actually popping it off the deck, there's no other work to be done there. Think of how cheap that is, right? You return from a task without the parent having been stolen. You immediately just start executing the continuation, and the only special code that got executed was popping a pointer off a deck. Nothing on the heap, and unstolen tasks are extremely cheap to execute. So the only expensive part is the actual steal itself, and that is still relatively cheap. All right, but now the last thing is typically the join continuation is run by whichever worker got to the join point last. It could be the worker that was running the child task or the worker that is running the continuation. One of them will get to the join point first, say, I can't go on from here, goes off and steals other work. The other one comes in there, says, oh, I'm done, and it continues from that point. Why can it do this and the child stealing scheduler doesn't do this? Because we've already paid the cost in writing code to resume at some arbitrary point in a function, and that's exactly, resuming after a join is exactly like resuming after stealing a continuation. So typically a child stealing scheduler stalls on a join, typically a parent stealing scheduler does not stall on a join. Each of these have different advantages. I'm right on time here, I think. But I do need to go quickly through this. All right, child stealing. A little easier to implement, especially if you don't have compiler support. It can be done completely as a library. TBB and PPL have proven this. Unlike parent stealing, you can kind of predict what worker is going to be running what. That is to say, there are certain points in which you know the same worker is running this piece of code as was running this piece of code. Before the fork and after the join, it's always the same worker in child stealing implementation. And that means your thread local storage and so on is predictable. Now, I do not recommend using thread local storage very much in parallel programming, but people do. People are used to using them for certain things. And as much as I tell people not to, it's something to keep in mind. On the other hand, there are a lot of mathematical and theoretical and somewhat practical advantages of continuation stealing. So there's bounds on queue size and memory used for the stack. And when you run it on a single worker, and I find this very useful, if you run a continuation scheduler on a single worker, every fork just looks like a function call, and every return from the function is just a return from the function. And it executes the code in exactly the same order as the serial code if you took out all of the parallel logic, right? So for debugging, for just sort of predicting how things are working, it's really nice to have that. It naturally lends itself to non-stalling joins. And non-stalling joins are more efficient than stalling joins because you don't idle a processor, right, which is the bad thing. And there's certain features that are easier to implement, like associative reducers. So the joke on my shirt was this is basically the Cilk team at Intel ribbing the TBB team at Intel, okay? It's just saying, like, who would steal children? Only monsters would steal children. Of course, you know, we're stealing parents, as if that's any better, but okay. That's the joke, okay? So now you have just effectively doubled the number of people in the world who understand this joke. All right, I'll quickly go through one important C++ consideration. Cactus stack is common to many types of parallel programming. And what it basically says, notices that if you have two things running in parallel in a call tree, they'd better have different stacks, right? So even though to each function, it looks like the stack is a linear thing. I'm calling a function gets spawned. If you look up the stack towards your caller and the caller's caller, those stack frames are there and they're solid and you can refer to variables that were passed to you from the caller's stack frame. But really in memory, it's this kind of tree structure that looks kind of like a cactus, except just like a tree, it's upside down because it's computer science. I shouldn't go into this. The stack can be implemented in different ways. You can read the slides later. Okay, but here's the problem with cactus stacks. You gotta watch out for your object lifetimes. If we have a function and it has a variable x here in it, and then we create over here a string str, it's in the same stack frame, but the stack frame is effectively grown. And then we spawn off some work, this child g, which refers to our string. It maybe got passed by reference. It refers to this string in the caller. Okay, and then we do in parallel, we do this work h, which also refers to this string in the caller. But then h finishes its work while g is still running. And guess what? There's no join point here. We just go off and run z. But before we run z, we pop this string off our stack. And guess what? We now have a dangling reference to something in our caller. So this is one of those races that parallel programming can get you into. But it's one of those races you might not notice, and that is the destructor is racing with something. The destructor is racing with something that's still using the variable. So just watch out. Okay, and there's Z running in parallel, but you know we've already caused problems for G. Garbage collected languages like Java and X10 don't have this problem. And so you don't hear them talking about the cactus stack as much. And when they do talk about it, they can still play these games where things can return while children are still running and not have to worry about these dangling references. Okay, I shouldn't mention that. That was meant to error. Okay, so in conclusion, stealing is good. All right, we just like in so much of computer programming, we use these terrible terms to refer to things that we actually like. So stealing is good. The programmer is the one that divides up the tasks so that they can automatically be shared and load balanced among different things. And the runtime automatically loads balances it and tries to be as greedy as possible. It's an important part of the parallelism story, right? You now understand it, I hope, if I did my job right, better than you did before you came in. And just like knowing how to do binary arithmetic, you may not use it very often, but you'll come upon a point where you're doing some parallel programming and you'll say, okay, I understand what the scheduler is going to do with this. And I think it'll make you a better parallel programmer. So thank you very much. I can stay a little, I know we're right on time, but I can stay and answer questions if people would like. Thank you. Yes. How do you choose what to?
What work to do in the child and what work to do in the continuation?
How do you choose what work to do in the child and what work to do in the continuation? Well, ideally, it shouldn't matter. and it has to do with your program structure. Remember, the child looks like the like a function call, and the continuation looks like what happens after a function call. And so, for example, in a loop, if you want to spawn off work in a loop, then it just kind of naturally falls out that the work you're spawning off is going to be done in the child, right? Because you can't spawn off the next piece of work in the loop until you finish the continuation. So you do as little work in the continuation as possible. Now, you have to be careful about that because your work and span can get way out of sync if you have a bunch of children spawned off linearly. But that's one way to decide. You could take into account what kind of scheduler, whether it's a child or parent scheduler, ceiling scheduler. If you're doing something really intricate, that might make sense. But most of the time, you do it, if you were writing the serial program, how would it be structured? And you structure it that way. Yes?
I'm wondering, what's the tooling story here? So for instance, in the last example, when you showed the active stack and the lifetime issue, are there any tools, I know, like thread sanitizer that would help us diagnose issues like this?
I think thread sanitizer would help you diagnose that, yes. And Cilk View, which works only with Intel Cilk Plus, also would detect that. Particular. Any race detector should detect that.
There is some support for Cilk in GCC. I've heard
that material. Yeah, there is Cilk support in GCC, but it doesn't support the Cilk View tool.
Right.
We're going to get it in there eventually, but we don't have it in there yet. Yes, I'm going to just kind of scan this way. Yes.
What compiler has support for continuation stealing?
So the Cilk Plus in the Intel compiler does continuation stealing. The MIT Cilk, which is only C-based, not C++, also does continuation stealing. And we have a prototype of continuation stealing with the standard proposed syntax. Yes?
That was basically my question. So the standard is heading towards parent stealing?
The standard is going to be agnostic as to the technology. It won't even specify that it's a work stealing at all, although that is by far the most likely scenario. But it's just going to specify the semantics of these things are in parallel and you know, whatever the runtime needs to do to make them in parallel. So it can be a continuation stealing or child stealing.
So then going back to the point of your talk of a better programmer, better C++ programmer understands what's going on. In this case, we wouldn't know exactly. You kind of have to know.
Right, you would need to know what your implementation is doing if that distinction occurs. But most of the things you care about is that it's almost certainly a work stealing scheduler, and that a lot of things are covered by that. And then there's a few real details that matter whether it's continuation or child stealing. Yes?
So you pointed out the problem with the destructor being lazy. Unless I missed it, I don't think you actually said what the solution is. Is it just
the solution in this solution in this case would be right. The solution was capture by value. There's two solutions to it. You could capture by value. You cannot pass by value. That won't help you because by the time this code, this actual call occurs, the destructor may already have run, right? Nobody wins a race when you have a race. Yes, pass by value wouldn't help, but capture by value would because the lambda is constructed before you go parallel. The other thing that would work is simply moving this declaration outside of the if so that its lifetime is longer and lasts to the join point.
I guess I was going to ask, would it, outside of moving it out of the scope, would a shared pointer to the string kind of solve this problem?
Yes, a shared pointer would also solve the problem, but that's overhead, yes. You have an extra heap allocation and an atomic counter and stuff like that. Yes? Yes.
How do you avoid that happening in the continuation with stolen?
What's happening is, so this is why continuation stealing requires compiler support. The compiler actually wraps that call with this little helper that the first instruction on returning from that function is, has my parent been stolen?
Oh.
You know, and it takes care of that. Oh. So, and in fact, that logic has to actually go, it gets pushed into the child itself. So that logic that's executing before the child has actually really returned.
So you found it yourself?
No, I mean, we have macros that simulate it, but the macros create this extra lambda that bundles up this extra, the helper, what we call the spawn helper. It takes the child and creates a child of a child. I mean, it creates an extra level of call indirection,
okay.
But it's a small extra thing.
How does the algorithm for stealing across the processors look like? So you have a data structure that contains a bunch of text. And
yes.
Then when one of the processors is idle, then you have to look into some other processor's deck, but which one?
Yes. It's typically random. The most common implementation uses random work stealing. It chooses one at random. And it was pointed out that, wow, that sounds kind of weird, right? It's like it rolls a die and does it. Well, you know, if you think about the laws of large numbers, your chances are you're going to eventually hit upon the processor that has work. There are some tuning things that some of the schedulers do, but you have to avoid adding overhead, right? So, you know, you can sort of think of like there's a random chance that suddenly all of the molecules of air in this room will go into this half of the room and all of us over here will suffocate. But it's very unlikely. So you can end up with a very bad schedule just by rolling a bunch of bad random numbers, but it's very unlikely. So random tends to work pretty well in practice. Yes? So do you manage the amount of steel? Okay, I'm going to try and answer the question as I understand it, because I'm not sure I understand your question right. You try and minimize the amount of work that's being stolen. And the way you try and minimize, you want to maximize the work that's available to steal and minimize the actual numbers of steals. And the way you do that is by spawning off, by creating tasks that have as much work and as much opportunity for subdivision as possible. And that's why you don't want to say for I equals 1 to 1,000, spawn a task for iteration I and then loop. Because then each task that you're spawning is just one element. What you're better off doing is say, let's spawn a task for the first half of the loop. And the continuation will be the second half of the loop. And then we'll subdivide that again. And we'll subdivide it again so that if some worker comes in and says, I'm going to steal the second half of the loop, they're stealing the entire second half of the loop, which it can then subdivide into quarters and eighths and so on. Whereas if you say, let's spawn the first iteration, and let's spawn the second iteration, and let's spawn the third iteration, each piece of work that's being stolen is very small. So it gets stolen, executed, done, and now we have to steal again. And stealing is, like I said, the most expensive thing. Right, you want an algorithm that keeps the span short and the, you know, relative to the work. And if you look at the work span diagram for the loop that I just described, it has a very long span. So yes, you want to keep the parallelism. There's no substitute for just choosing a good algorithm that works well with parallelism. And sometimes it's not the same algorithm you'd use for serial. That's right. So there is an explicit weight, but you don't need it very often. Here. So this is the standard syntax. So there's actually a call for weight, all right? But you don't need it very often because usually we're going to say, okay, in this region, this task block, we're going to spawn some tasks. And at the end of the task block, we want to join them all. So the join is implicit, as it's shown here in this blue call out. Right. At the end of the task block, there's an implicit join. So it's kind of scoped, like your parallelism is scoped that way. And that way you don't forget to join, which is bad. And you get races and all sorts of bad things happen. And the reason why you actually would want the explicit one is so you can do a conditional join. We almost didn't have an explicit one at all. But pointed out that if you do some work, suppose you have like two arrays you want to work on, right? You can work on them in parallel. But if there's overlap between them, you don't want to work on them in parallel. So you do some work, you spawn some tasks, and then you say, if they overlap, I want to do a wait, an explicit join now, and then do the other part, so that way I don't have arrays. But if they don't overlap, don't join. Just keep going and join later. All the way over here. Ah, yes. Well, it's not really needed in terms of the theory. What it does do is it passes the data structure to the runtime that makes the runtime job a little easier. It also ties together the different parts. And in particular, if I call a function, I can pass the task block in, and that function can then spawn more work on the same task block. Whereas if I did it completely lexically, it wouldn't be able to do that because it wouldn't be able to find the innermost task block that it belongs to. So this is it's a token that says this is our innermost task block. It has some disadvantages too, but for a library implementation, it turned out, because the syntax, you see, it's a library, there's no keywords in there. It turns out that the advantages of this versus the advantages of not having it won out, but they were both considered. Yes, Mike? Oh, yes, you're right. That is an error in the thing after the task block should not be a closed paren. It should be the beginning of, it should be a comma and the beginning of a lambda. Yeah, thanks for that. You, and then. Is the task that a continuation, that a child stealing scheduler bundles up, is that like a coroutine? Not really, and I'll tell you why, because the task hasn't started yet, so it doesn't actually have a stack frame yet. And then when it's done, its stack frame will go away. So unlike a coroutine, which keeps the stack frame around for a while, there are some parts of these schedulers, when you actually get into it, that do look like coroutines. But that's not really what's going on. And then you had a question? No, there wouldn't be a race because you would. No, there would still be a race unless you captured it by value. You're absolutely right. So in the case of the shared pointer, you have to make sure that somebody is making a copy of the shared pointer before you've gone parallel. It's a little bit similar to what Herb was talking about earlier today. This capture by value is really important. It's a really useful way of preventing some of these problems. So in this code here, we want to capture anything where the destructor might race. We want to capture it by value. Even if it's a shared pointer, we want to copy the shared pointer before the first instance of that shared pointer goes out of scope. Yeah, boy, there's a lot of questions. I hope that means I did a good job and not that I just left a lot of stuff unsaid. Okay, let's just take a couple more. Yes. Yeah, so there was proposals to have executors that would do parallelism. And that's definitely a possibility. I mean, in a sense, this task block is kind of like an executor. So it's really the direction that the executor's proposal is taking in the standard has become more efficient. It's more about generic programming and less runtime polymorphism, which means it might actually be usable for parallelism. So this, between what we have here and what actually makes it to the standard, you might see the executors creep in there. Yeah. All right, over here. Yes. Ah, Right, yes. So how do you decide when to stop subdividing, when it becomes a point of diminishing returns? Measure. You measure. Measuring is definitely, you know, in parallelism, if you're not measuring what you're doing, you're not going to end up getting the best results. Last one. Okay, so if a task blocks on something other than parallel control flow, is that what you're saying? Yes, that's bad. And so, again, that distinction between parallelism and concurrency I was talking about before, you want to avoid things like mutexes and condition variables and queues between things in your tasks, because typically, If any synchronization construct that isn't aware of the underlying parallelism subsystem will just cause one of your workers to just stall. Hopefully not with a deadlock, but even without the deadlock, it's stalled. It's waiting for something to happen, and you're not getting maximum parallelism. So generally, you want to avoid concurrent programming inside of your parallel programming. Mutexes may be the one exception. Mutexes are expensive. You want to avoid them in general. They serialize things, so you lose parallelism. But sometimes you can't get around them. But at least they're self-bounded. You try and keep the mutex in a critical region as small as possible. So I'll take Detlef's questions since he's been patient, and then we're going to have to call it a day. I don't really have a really great answer for you for how do you actually measure if you're trying to write scalable software that's going to run on different hardware. A lot of the measurements I've done seem to scale like there's, you just see the point of diminishing returns off on the knee to the curve, and it almost doesn't really matter if you're going to run on 4 cores or 100. Other times it's not the case. Other times you have to measure on the machine that you want to run on, and maybe try and figure out a formula that says, well, for this many cores, we'll go to this level of coarseness, and for more cores, we'll go to a finer grain. It is a little bit of a black art, as much as we try and make a science out of it. All right, well, thank you very much, everybody. Have a good evening.